This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
If you want to understand the natural horsemanship phenomenon that exists today, you have to understand the work, the contributions of a man by the name of Tom Dorrance. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for The Horse Show. I'm going to tell you right in advance, sometimes I struggle when I talk about Tom Dorrance because I don't want to put words in his mouth. I don't want to misrepresent him or be presumptuous in any way. I was not one of his students. I never even met the gentleman. He was born in 1910, died in 2003. He left a lasting legacy without really intending to. It was just that this people saw that he had something special and kind of glommed onto him. And he saw that he could help people. He saw that he could help horses. And I think that that's ultimately how he kind of got drug into this industry that has sprung up around it. We're going to talk, but before we do that even, I want to mention just a few things because I think some of the most important stuff that he left us is the simplest to understand. And in my mind, simple things are quite often the most brilliant. Simplicity has its own form of brilliance. And here are some of the things that Tom Dorrance is known for saying. And I consider these sort of prescriptions, observations, suggestions. But here's some of them. Make the wrong things difficult and the right things easy. Let your idea become the horse's idea. Be as gentle as possible and as firm as necessary. The slower you do it, the quicker you'll find it. Feel what the horse is feeling and operate from where the horse is. Do less to get more. Take the time it takes. And finally, the horse is never wrong. Now, those are typical of how simple the language that Tom Dorrance used was, but how much was packed into it. There's a book that I think anybody that's serious about horsemanship should have in their library. They should read it over and over again. It will kind of unfold gradually over time. It's called True Unity. It's Tom Dorrance's work as interpreted by Millie Hunt Porter, who was the first wife of Tom's most important student, Mr. Ray Hunt, who kind of took Tom's work out to the public in the 1970s. Ray Hunt is no longer with us either, by the way. So we have kind of the next generation of students of Tom Dorrance and Ray Hunt, and they are full of useful insights as well. And we're going to explore those today with one of the best, Mr. John St. Ryan, a very interesting man himself, an accomplished actor, narrator, martial artist, and of course, a fine horseman who's interested not only in the Dorrance approach, but also Doma Vaquero, the Spanish approach. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. And we'll be back. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at FarnamHorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
For For 60 years, the United States Pony Club has been developing character, leadership, confidence, and a sense of community in youth through a program that teaches the care of horses and ponies, riding, and mounted sports. Red Brand Fence is proud to support these initiatives as the official education sponsor of Pony Club. Through Red Brand's Fence 101 curriculum, Pony Club members can learn correct selection and installation of fence, helping to keep their horses and ponies safe and secure. Learn more by clicking on the Pony Club button at redbrand.com.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's G-R-O-strong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Hey, welcome back, everybody. In the interview that you're about to hear, we're going to talk about a gentleman that I think is very important, this entire revolution in horsemanship that you hear me talk about so often. His name is Tom Dorrance. He was born in 1910. He died in 2003, but his memory is certainly still with us. And now, thanks to the efforts of my guest today, you can hear and see him talking about some of these very concepts. My guest is somebody who was, I think, a protege of him, and we'll ask how he feels about that description in just a moment. My guest is John St. Ryan. John, welcome to the Horse Show.
Thank you, Rick. Good to be here.
Is that a fair way to describe you? Were you kind of a protege of Tom Dorrance?
I'd like to say I was a student. I wish I knew more than I did, but I think that's just the way it's always going to be when you're following the work that Tom did.
He was a bit tough to understand sometimes, wasn't he?
Well, it was kind of like reading the book for the first time. You'd be around horses for however many years, and then people tell you about this man that's so incredible, his way of working with horses, and then they say, oh, by the way, he's got a book out. So you immediately go and buy the book, and you start to read it, and it's interesting, and then you start not understanding exactly where things are going, simply because for the most part in books on horsemanship you're looking at a modular approach where the way things are expressed is pretty clear, and you take step one, step two, step three, and it gets you to step four and so on. And the way the book's written is the way that Tom worked. It was from where you were with the horse, and most importantly, where the horse was. So he worked from where the horse was, and each horse is unique and completely different, and then went on from there. And the way he expressed this in the book seemed very eclectic and very esoteric, and that got in the way of the understanding for quite some time for me, and I believe for quite a lot of other people. But then if you keep the book and you continue to try, and if you've been fortunate enough to visit with Tom and maybe attend his clinics, then you start to see what he was talking about and see that this works, and then you have to dig in a little bit deeper within yourself to try and get it to happen for yourself.
Well, certainly it requires a commitment, I think, and I'm like you. As I go back to the book, each time I go back to the book, it unfolds a little bit more, and I found the same thing true with his number one student, I suppose would be the easiest way to say it, Ray Hunt, who kind of brought Tom out into the public eye. A lot of people would probably never even have heard of this man were it not for Ray Hunt. In the book I wrote with Dr. Miller, the way I described it is I felt that what they were talking about, they both had such a commitment to being as honest and true in what they were saying in their book as they could be. This is such a highly subjective thing, and it changes. It's so fluid. You talk about him working with where you are with the horse. Well, that is different at every moment, It's different with every person. It's different with every horse. It's such a slippery subject.
Yes, that's very true. It kind of defies what you might look at as being a logical approach because you're trying to deal with the moment.
And I always liked what Ray Hunt said. He said, you adjust to fit the situation. And within that little nugget, and both he and Tom left us many nuggets of that kind, within that little nugget, it's kind of the whole essence of this. It's not if this happens, do this, if this happens. It's not a matrix of what to do in what situation because the situation cannot be defined ahead of time. And so
that's right. And that's where you got that, as you said, that phrase came from Tom, adjust to fit the situation that best fits the occasion. These are things he was fond of repeating because it needed repeating and understanding that each moment in time with the horse is dissimilar. What worked yesterday may need some modification today because of the conditions. And the conditions may be externally, as in a change in the environment, where you're working, are you in a barn, an arena, are you out in the range or whatever? Or a change in the horse's state. Well, is the horse, he was happy in the arena, but he's not happy outside. There are still ways to get the job done.
Well, certainly it's all a balancing act. And, you're balancing the idea of being consistent in how you present requests to a horse and how you present yourself and your own leadership and your own body language. Consistency, on the one hand, versus being flexible enough to adjust to fit the situation. Let me ask you before we get too far into this to talk a little bit about yourself. You are a professional horseman, a professional clinician. Give me a little short version of what John St. Ryan's all about.
Well, I was born in England and raised in Ireland, and I rode horses for the fun of it in Europe. But while I was in Spain, I saw some incredible horsemanship, and that did make a lasting impression on me, which took me to where I am today, maybe, with the help of the work that I did with Tom and learned from him. But my career in England was more, I was an actor and did some work over there, some TV and film and so on. And I came to the U.S. in 92, had a three-picture deal with Canon Films. While I was here, I was invited to Robert Wagner's ranch outside L.A. to watch this man called Ray Hunt work with horses. And I'd just been recommended I should watch this man. I'd never seen him or heard of him even before. I'd just come over to the U.S. And I spent 4 days entranced by this man's philosophy and work. But then beside all this, Ray would continually give credit to this man called Tom Dorrance. So I had to find him. And I heard that there was a clinic going to be held down at Bill Devane's ranch in Indio in California. And Tom was doing a four-day clinic. So I drove down there and watched Tom work. I remember the agent called and said I needed to be back the second day for a meeting. Well, I never made that meeting. But I spent 4 days with Tom down there, and I've never regretted a moment. And that just about changed everything around. I just became absolutely focused on this work with horses. And I wanted to try to apply Tom's way of working with horses and learn as much as I could.
My guest is California horseman John St. Ryan. We're talking about his mentor and the father of natural horsemanship, the late, great Tom Dorrance. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. Don't you dare go away. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com.
Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pen, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pen. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Welcome back to the Horse Show, everybody. I'm Rick Lamb. My guest is California horseman John St. Ryan. We're talking about his mentor, the late, great Tom Dorrance.
I was invited up to Tom's place in Salinas, and he suggested I bring some horses. And that was one of the most profound moments in my life, because over the years I took horses up to work with Tom, and some were pretty straightforward and some were one step from the cannery. And Tom treated them all the same. He showed me how to get the results that I so wanted. And, you know, I look back on earlier days, I can't imagine how or why he has so much patience with me, but that's how he was. And he was wonderful with horses. He was wonderful with people. I guess I just had maybe some residual effect from the martial arts. I taught martial arts for 27 years prior to this, and maybe I was getting good results with the horses because of a little better feel and balance just because of the martial arts. I don't know, but one thing led to another, and people began asking me for help with their horses. This gave me a lot of concern, because despite teaching martial arts for so long, I didn't really consider myself able to train horses for people. But working with Tom just helped me. It gave me confidence, and it just developed on from there.
Well, let me ask you this about working with him, because you mentioned what it was like for you when you first read his book, True Unity,
yeah.
And how you struggled with some of the concepts as expressed on the printed page. How was it different for you working with him in the flesh?
Well, it was right there in the moment, and so many times he'd say something, you know, he'd ask me to do something, whether it was go around in a circle, go around in the arena, walk the horse this way, walk the horse slower, walk it down this hill and walk it back up, walk it across the bridge, take off at a canter, whatever it was, he'd have a reason for doing it. And I wasn't sure what that reason was, but as the time progressed, it became clearer. And sometimes it didn't clear up that day, but I might go home and then it'd dawn on me what he was trying to do. Like I asked him to help me with lead changes one time. You know, he'd say, what do you want to do? And I said, well, I'd really like to get lead changes better. You know, I'm floundering around here. And he says, okay, let's go over here. And he had 7 tires cut out, half tires just cut out. And he'd say, right, now walk your horse through those tires. And I'm saying, well, I didn't say it, but I thought, well, I'll do this, and then we can maybe go and do the lead changes. So anyway, I'm trying to get through these tires, and I'm clouncing all over the place, and the horse I'm on is, you know, just tripping over him or jumping to the side because he's not sure. And he'd have me crossing them one way and then another, and then I got a little bit better as the session went on. Then he'd have me do something else. I'd go away after maybe 3 or 4 days, and I'd be thinking, I wanted to get the lead changes, and I didn't get it. I forgot to ask him again because he got me so embroiled in trying to get this horse to walk through the tires. And then it occurred to me, well, he was trying to get me to feel the feet. And when I knew where the feet were, then I could probably get these lead changes better.
Mm.
And so I got home, and I ran down to the tire store and got some old tires, cut them off, and got to where I could get my horse to walk through these tires evenly, put a foot in each one. I knew where the feet were. I wasn't just fumbling through or stumbling through them, I knew where the feet were. And then after that, I tried trying to get a change, a lead change. And it was, oh, it was so easy.
Because you knew where each foot was.
I knew where the feet were.
And you knew the right moment to ask him to do something with his feet that he could actually do what you're asking him to do.
That's right. And you see, and Tom didn't say, oh, try to do this. This will get you fixed up. He just said, try it and see. And then he left it to me to figure it out. And I really, I didn't know at the time. I had no idea. But I always look on back on that one thing and think, you know, there's a really odd way of figuring out what you need to do.
You know, I've talked to quite a few guys, John, and ladies that have had the similar experience with Tom. And most of them were very serious about their horsemanship, and they were willing to, they could kind of put up with this uncertainty and not feeling like they got the answer to the question and this confusion, and they kind of had enough trust and all of that to benefit from it. Were there also people that would come to Tom and just walk away scratching their head and say, I don't know what he's talking about, but he can't help me, and then go on to somebody else?
Yeah, I mean...
So he wasn't for everybody.
No, you'd see it at... It's like Tom would say about the way he worked with horses. He'd say, you don't have to do these things in order to get along and do well and be successful with a horse, but only if you're interested. But he would add that sometimes it's more interesting and more rewarding, especially for the horse.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where his thoughts lay. And, you know, you could go to a clinic and watch people. And when I was there, I just couldn't stop asking him questions. He'd say, anybody, any questions? And I'd dive in, and then it got embarrassing because I was always diving in. So I'd try and sit back a little bit and let somebody else ask. But you could look around the arena and watch, and there were people just sitting on the sidelines and chewing. And, you know, you'd have, if you were in the stands, you could hear people say, oh, well, you know, you should be correcting that person's riding position. Look at it. It's awful. It's the last thing Tom was going to correct you on. He was going to maybe help you find something, but he was looking at the horse and how it was shaping up for the horse. And,
well, that's interesting. So he wasn't somebody that was real hung up on form much as he was on, he kind of let function dictate form, it sounds like.
Yeah, and then, when he would talk about feel the whole horse, he has a whole chapter in there. And that was so special, just to say that, feel the whole horse, because then you learn how unique each one is, and you study their actions and their reactions, and then you try to learn how to present yourself in a way that the horse will respond to what you're asking of them. And Tom would go to great lengths to stress the importance of looking at a horse as a horse. He was so sure that horses naturally had tremendous faith in humans, but the humans often didn't measure up to this trust. So he asked you to look at the horse as a horse and look at this instinct that they had of self-preservation,
mm-hmm.
and then recognize it and can always consider it when you make your approach to the horse. And as time goes on, if you keep working in that direction, you'll develop this confidence and bond.
Still to come, more on the self-preservation of the horse and why the horse is never wrong. My guest is California horseman John St. Ryan. We're talking about his mentor, the late, great Tom Dorrance. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show. Stay with us. Hey, everybody. Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world, like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
I'm talking about Tom Dorrance with one of his students, John St. Ryan. Certainly the concept was there through Tom's work and came out very clearly in Ray's work even today, that the horse is never wrong. The horse does not set out to maliciously try and thwart your goals or mess you up. It's just doing what it thinks is right in the moment. Would you agree with that?
Yes. Again, that's looking at that self-preservation. They're just trying to look out for themselves.
Can't be anything else other than a horse.
Exactly. And then you're trying to work with that until you get that confidence. And because they want to be right, if you go about it the right way most of the time, and this is just down to that timing, this is the whole crux of the field timing and balance. It takes a lot of effort from the human to do this, but when you get that, then you can get that thing that Tom had always said. It was always amusing to me the way he'd explain. You want to feel like you could ride your horse up a telephone pole or down a badger hole. You won't do either, but it'll feel like it. And that was his way of explaining that willing communication between horse and human.
I never had the pleasure of meeting him. I've talked to his wife or widow, Margaret, a number of times on the phone, and certainly many people such as yourself who worked very closely with him, but I never had the opportunity to meet him. But one of the things that repeatedly comes out is the gentle spirit, the sweetness, if you will. He was known for sometimes saying, you're just too precious. Let me give you an idea to help you with that, because I don't want to see you get hurt.
Yes.
But kind of switching gears a little bit on this, John, where did groundwork fit in for Tom? And we talk a lot about riding, and there's certainly a rush to ride. When people get involved with horses, they think about riding the horse.
Yes.
And yet so much of the relationship is built from the ground. How important was that to Tom?
I'm not altogether convinced that it was so important to him, especially in his own years, formative years, and as time went on, because I've heard him say that I like to get these things done when I'm on the horse's back. I feel more safe doing that. And, you know, he'd tell me about some of the things he'd done, and I'd think, oh, good Lord, I think I'd like to try and get something fixed up earlier than before I crawl on that horse's back. But yeah. He was just, he felt so confident within himself that he wouldn't get in the horse's way. Mm-hmm. And he had the ability to get through to the horse that he would do these things and without any need for a lot of groundwork. I think that, and I'm just guessing here, but I think that as time went on, he saw the benefit of it for other people who didn't have that innate confidence and ability to get with the horse immediately when they get on their back.
There you go. I think that's exactly right. In fact, it's amazing how this whole revolution kind of took shape because, you know, if it had not been for Ray Hunt kind of taking the work of Tom out to the public, all of it might not happen the way it did. If it weren't for people, the next generation coming on, even after Ray, who could take what he tried so hard to explain, and Tom did, and put it and kind of distill it down to even something simpler that folks who don't have the same kind of commitment, who have virtually no experience at all with horses, could really understand and be empowered by and be enthused enough and start getting some positive results. And number one, stay safe, because, you know, that's the surest way to drive somebody away from the whole glorious experience with a horse is getting hurt and just saying, hey, I've got this fear, I've got this hang up now. I don't want to be anywhere near a horse because I just can't handle that. So, I think that they were central, and Ray, of course, still is. But it couldn't have happened the way it did if there weren't people to kind of interpret and carry forward. People like you, for instance. Do you have any sense of who Tom learned from? Now, I know he's famous for saying, I learned from the horse, but there had to have been some people that influenced him. And one name I'll just throw out there is Cliff Wade. Do you know much about their relationship?
Only little bits of what Tom said, but I think it was one of the things that he said, and I might be paraphrasing this, but we talk about Tom's ability with horses, and I often thought, well, this is something that he had naturally. You know, it was just a great gift. But, you know, when I've talked to him, and we'd sit down and talk, and I'd listen to him about things, I don't think it was strictly a natural thing, because I think he worked really hard at this skill. And he did, you know, get with people like Cliff Wade. And in the foreword to his book, he talks about that. I'm going to paraphrase this maybe, but this is what he said, I think. He would say, this is something I've had to develop in myself, for myself, by myself. Mm. The true unity and willing communication between the horse and me isn't something that I can hand to someone. It has to be learned. It has to come from the inside of a person and the inside of a horse. Mm-hmm. You know, he was on the ranch half a century in Oregon, and there wasn't anybody else there. So he had to get things done.
Right.
Because there was nobody else to pick up the pieces.
Well, I know he had three brothers, Jim, Bill, Fred, and then, of course, he was the youngest of the four. His brother Fred, as I've heard it told, was possibly the most naturally gifted horseman of the group, but he died tragically at a pretty young age, and he was the one that Tom most often would go to. His oldest brother Jim was good with horses, but he kind of liked him when they had a lot of fire and buck and so forth to him, and he liked to ride rough stock. And then his brother Bill, which is really the one that the public probably has also heard of, Bill Dorrance. In your experience, how similar were the two of them as far as their horsemanship was concerned?
Tom introduced me a couple of times up there, but I was never around Bill with horses. Mm-hmm. So I've only got hearsay, and it's just, from what I can tell, they were fairly different. They were just a different approach. And even so far as perhaps when they talk about feel, timing, and balance, Tom's emphasis was on the first part, feel. And I think perhaps Bill's emphasis might have been on the second part, timing, which mm-hmm. was most important. But again, I never really sat down with Bill.
What do you think, as a human being, made Tom so effective with horses? Have you been able to put your finger on anything?
Well, one of the other things he would say, he wants the horse to feel that they would rather be with him, whether he was on the ground or on their back. Yeah, I'm sure it's happened to you, Rick. You know, you've gone out to get a horse, and that horse is maybe in 5 acres, and you suddenly find a lot of distance being created between you and the horse when you're going to catch him. He doesn't want to be with you.
Mm-hmm.
And you start, well, what am I doing wrong here? And it can be pretty miserable if the horse doesn't want to take part in the proceedings. Now, the way Tom would be, he just always tried to be good with a person, and he'd always try and look for the good in the person and look for the good in the horse. So everything that he did, it carried through in his everyday life and his dealings with people. Every time I visited Tom, I came away with this great sense of well-being and contentment. Just being with him was so rewarding. Despite what I learned from him, he was just fun to be around. It was good to be around. It wasn't all serious horse talk. Also, he's kind of like the way he's with a horse. I couldn't do everything he asked me to do with a horse, but he never threw his hands in despair or quit me. He'd just take a fresh start, maybe go another direction, and it made it so I never felt bad. But I really wanted to keep trying to learn whatever he was offering. And this is the thing that I try and do when I'm around the horses I'm around. I don't want them to feel bad either. And I want to help them learn. So that sense that you would get from Tom was so important. It was just something he had within himself that just made you feel really good.
No doubt Tom Dorrance was a gentle man, and yet he knew how to turn up the heat on a horse when that was necessary. We'll explore that when I continue talking with John St. Ryan. This is The Horse Show. I'm Rick Lamb. Don't you dare go away.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
Imagine this. Your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with the lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com. And while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
You know, a lot of people think that if you have horses, you have to put up with flies, or you have to install big spray systems or deal with stinky traps or messy tapes. Not true. You can use Spalding Fly Predators, tiny, safe, easy-to-use, and inexpensive beneficial insects that kill flies before they emerge and become a problem. Do like I did and find out more about Spalding Fly Predators. Visit flypredators.net or call 1-888-282-7262. That's 1-888-282-7262.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition.
Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need.
Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at farnamhorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
You know, I say it every single week, but it's absolutely true. The best thing you can do to help us out is just tell people about our show, both our radio and television shows. All that information is available at thehorseshow.com. My guest is California horseman John St. Ryan. We're talking about his mentor, Tom Dorrance. Obviously, Tom genuinely loved horses. He felt the affection that we all do and was not reluctant to show that to the horse. What was the flip side of that? Because this, again, is one of those things that you have to balance. You have to balance affection and nurturing and loving and supporting a horse with being an effective leader, with being confident and strong and being worthy of your horse's trust. How did Tom manifest that idea? Did you ever see him really get after a horse?
No, because
let me phrase it this way, because one of his principles is gentle as possible and firm as necessary.
Yeah.
How firm did he get?
Well, when I was up there, he kind of worked through me. And there were so many times when he'd asked me to maybe turn the heat up a little bit. Mm-hmm. And I remember one horse in particular I took up. She was a big warm-blood mare. And she developed this nasty habit of rearing and bucking and biting. And that was before you even got on her. She wasn't my horse, and I picked her up from this barn where she was boarded, and the handlers that brought her out put a muzzle on her just to get her in the trailer. And I took her up to Tom's. I asked him if I could take her first, you know. And he said, yeah, well, it sounds like a good project, you know. So he showed me how to feel where this mare was having trouble and how to head it off. Now, it could be something as simple as that you'd saddle her and she could reach around and just bite you so hard, you know. One time she reared up, and as she was coming down, she reached down, bit my arm, and picked me up and threw me.
Oh, my gosh.
That's how tough this thing was. And so that's one of the reasons I wanted to take her up to Tom to help me get that. Wow. I didn't want that to happen again. So we were doing this one session, and it was the first day, and I said, look, you know, I've got to be real careful. And he said, well, I'll watch you. Just try and head it off before it happens. And just as he said that, she'd swing around and he'd say, you're late. And I'd say, okay. And now before it happens, and he'd say, I'm watching her. Are you watching her? And I'd say, I'm watching her. He said, you're late. And she'd swing around. And I'm saying, well, I swear I'm watching her, Tom, but I can't see what you're seeing. Tom, it's like she's just doing this out of the blue. I don't know how I can stop this because I can't see what I'm trying to stop. So he stood there and he looked at me and he said, well, here, take this. And he just gave me the end of a little stick. And he said, now, just before this mare bites you or swings around to bite you, you're going to see her in her eye and in her ears maybe, and then it's going to be too late. And he said, I'll tell you when, but I want you to just give her a sharp rap under the chin. Just give her a tap. And I thought, well, that's not going to, I don't know how that's going to do anything. But I thought, well, I'm not going to argue. I never did. I just believed what he told me and tried to apply it. So anyway, he's there, and I'm about to through the saddle on, and I reached down for the cinch, and all the time I was ready with the stick, and just, he said, now. So I just immediately did what he said, and I tapped her under the chin. And he said, right, now go ahead. And I went on, and I carried on, cinched up, put the back cinch on, put the breast collar on. He says, there, now that wasn't hard, was it? And I said, well, I'll be darned. I said, I didn't see it coming. And it just looked like she was coming right out of the blue. And Tom smiled. He said, yeah, well, that's probably what she thought about you. I don't know why I got tapped like that. It came right out of the blue.
I thought what you were going to say was that if he was trying to get your timing such that she started thinking that she had done that to herself.
Well, yeah, it was kind of, but he probably saw it before. Mm-hmm. The thought came in, and he saw it, and he told me where to apply it, and that was it.
Yeah.
You know, now that didn't clear it up forever. I had more times to practice, and even with that mare, just putting the bridle on it was a work of art, because she'd take your hand, you know, and I was trying so hard just to put the snaffle bit on her, and she'd lower her head, then she'd bring it over this way and that way, and if you push too hard, she'd bite you.
Mm-hmm.
And Tom watched this for a while, and then he oh, just a minute, hang on, and he came over to me and took the bridle off me, and now I'm really scared, because this horse has, like I said, just bitten me and thrown me a couple of days earlier, and I'm watching him, and he's looking pretty frail, but he reached up and he swung the bridle so that the snaffle bit just came right, swung it underneath her chin, so it was all in one nice smooth motion, and then brought it up to her lips, and then put the bridle in her mouth, and he said, there, and he walked off.
Wow. What did you make of that?
Well, he'd been trying to get me to do that, and I just hadn't seen it. I couldn't figure out how he was going to do it, and I kept, you know, fiddling around, and then he kind of didn't get frustrated. He just thought, well, I'll just show you this, and then you can take a picture of it in your mind, and then you can copy it. So yeah. Then I did exactly what he did. Yeah. It wasn't just as smooth, but I got it done. And then after that, I didn't have an issue with it. But it seemed such a simple thing to do, but I was terrified that this man was going to bite him, but he just did it.
Okay, John, I told you ahead of time I wanted you to think of the three most important principles that you personally learned from Tom Dorrance. What did you come up with?
It was a hard choice, Rick, you know, but I mean, I think the three most important principles that I can really take to offer people is, number one, feel the whole horse. Number two, adjust to fit the situation that best fits the occasion. And then number three, get the horse to feel that they'd rather be with you, whether you're on their ground or on their back. And if you can work on those three things, there's so much that can springboard off of that.
Excellent. John, like I said, we could talk for days about what you have done. I'm going to invite you to be on my show another time and talk about that. You've got some very interesting things in that you're involved with the Doma Vaquero work. We've talked at some length on our show with other people about that in the past. I'd be interested in hearing about that. And some of the other things you do. But you do have a website that we could direct people to. Why don't you give them that web address?
Yeah, it's www.johnstryan.com.
Just exactly like it sounds. And by the way, folks, John, if you recognize his voice, it may be because you've heard him narrate the True Unity audio series that was the book, the audio version of Tom's book, correct?
Yes, that's right. And if you don't go to my site, that's fine. But I'd really like you to go to Tom's site, and that's www.tomdorrance.com. Yeah. There's a lot of information on that, on his site, and it takes you to his book and so on, and then his new DVD.
And that new DVD, by the way, we didn't really give too much information about it. It's called Feel, Timing, and Balance with Tom Dorrance. Margaret Dorrance and you worked together on that. You are officially the producer of that. Was that a difficult project to do?
Yes, it was, because you feel so much responsibility to put things in the way you believe it would be right for Tom. When I did the first one, when I did Greetings, I had the good fortune of Tom still being with us. And so when I'd do an edit, I took it up and sat with him And sometimes we didn't get beyond 10 minutes, and he'd say, this isn't very good, I don't like it. And when I finally made the edit he liked, I was sitting there on pins for probably, I don't know, an hour and a half, thinking, well, he hasn't said anything. He's either fallen asleep or something. And at the end of it, he just said, yeah, that seems like it might help, you know. So,
all right.
But in this one, it's it was a little tougher, and I felt the pressure a little more. But thankfully, Margaret is a wonderful person, and she kind of would go through it with me, and I'd send her a copy of the edit, and she'd give me her ideas and what she thought was right and what would be correct for people.
Good. Well, I know you share my desire to do right by Tom and his memory, and most of all, present his thoughts as accurately as we can, and get them out there for people to benefit from them as we have. My guest, ladies and gentlemen, has been John St. Ryan. His website again, www.johnstryan, all spelled out, .com. Thank you so much, and do me a favor and come on our show again sometime.
Thank you, Rick. I enjoyed talking with you.
And that has to be one of the most interesting and enjoyable interviews I've ever done. John St. Ryan, actor, martial arts expert, and of course a horseman, a teacher of horsemanship, a student, a committed student of the horsemanship of his mentor, Tom Dorrance. And of course, that was our topic today. JohnSt.Ryan.com is his website, but as he mentioned, I'll say it again, please visit TomDorrance.com, TomDorrance. This is the official website dedicated to the horsemanship and the memory of Tom Dorrance, and the proceeds from any sales there go to benefit his widow, Margaret Dorrance, who's been very gracious towards me and certainly, as John mentioned, towards him as well. Now, there are some products available that feature the horsemanship of Tom Dorrance. His book, True Unity, a must for every serious horseman's library. The audio version of that, as we mentioned, John narrated. That is also available. There is a Greetings from Tom Dorrance videotape that was done in the 90s with Tom on camera. And then this posthumous one that we talked about today that John has produced in association with Margaret Dorrance called Field Timing and Balance with Tom Dorrance. All that's available at TomDorrance.com. Please check it out. This is something for, I think, every serious horseman to study. An interesting thing about John, I noticed, that he seemed to have an inner calm, an inner peace, and kind of a gentle spirit. And I've noticed this about other students of Tom Dorrance, and I've always wondered, were they like that before and they just kind of gravitated towards him, or was that his influence on people? Good question. Remember my website, thehorseshow.com. You can listen to past editions of my show, shop in our shopping mall, see what's coming up on my TV show on RFD TV every week. And of course, my books. You can buy my books. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.